Welcome to Bible Tract Echoes. This program is the radio ministry of Bible Tracts Incorporated. Our mission is to take the Word of God to all the world. Our Bible teacher is the director of Bible Tracts, Pastor Mark Smith. Since 1938, Bible Tracts Incorporated has been publishing clear gospel tracts and supplying them to churches, missionaries, and individuals all over the world, and all at no charge. Information on how you can receive a free sample pack of our tracts will be given at the end of this broadcast. Now for our Bible study, here is our teacher, Pastor Mark Smith.
Welcome, my friend. Welcome to the middle of the week, the second day of the new year. It's great to be with you. I appreciate so much you allowing us here at Bible Tract Echoes to be a part of your day. Right now, my Bible is sitting open. It's sitting open to the book of Ruth. If you can, reach over, pick up your own copy of the Word of God and join me there, Ruth and chapter 1. Also, pick up a pen and paper. Have them ready for jotting down some notes. I'm going to give my big, broad outline for the book of Ruth here today. You may want to jot it down just to kind of check me out later on and read through the book of Ruth yourself. But with that pen and paper handy, you can get the information that we want to give to you jotted down, because I have some gospel tracts I want to put into your hand. Do you know what a gospel tract is? Well, yes, it's an evangelism tool, but it's a tool that's designed in written format in a small enough packaging so that we can just keep it in our shirt pocket, in our purse, wherever, and we can have it ready to hand to somebody and give them the gospel, even if we cannot verbally tell them the gospel. A gospel tract is simply a short written presentation of God's plan of salvation. Please, I have a free sample packet with about 40 tracts in there. I want to give it to you. Did I mention that it's free? Well, please. At the end of the program, my announcer will give our contact information, and you can give us your name and address, and we'll be glad to send that free sample packet to you. I'll say more about that here in just a moment. Let me lead into the Bible study this way. Every once in a while, my wife and I find ourselves in the middle of a task, which when we look at each other and we ask the question, why are we doing this? Sometimes the very same sentiment comes out this way, and we're doing this because most of the time this happens seemingly when we volunteer to help somebody out. And what first was just a small project turns into a mammoth one, and one we would never have started to be gotten involved with at all if we'd known what the end was going to be. No, please tell me that you've been in that same situation yourself. But I'm asking you today to join me in a task. The task is to walk through the book of Ruth. I call it rummaging through Ruth. I could tell you that Ruth is a part of God's love letter to you, and so therefore, since it's from God, you ought to want to know about it. But usually that kind of motivation doesn't do much for me. So I don't think it's going to do much for you either. So today, I want to give you some reasons to walk through Ruth with me in the day-by-day study here in the book. So get a pen and paper. Join me, Ruth chapter 1. Before I begin to read there, I have one of those gospel tracts in my hand right now. This one's entitled, Where Are the Dead? Where Are the Dead? I cannot tell you how many times the whole idea of what happens to people after they die has led into a gospel presentation by me to somebody. Do you know that people think about this? God has put eternity in the hearts of people, even lost people, and they wonder what happens to people when they die. Well, this gospel tract, Where Are the Dead, answers it, both if you know Christ is saved. Well, let me read you how the tract begins. It says, where are the dead? That depends on how they died. You can die in the Lord or in your sins. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. You were born with a sinful nature. You are not a sinner because you sin. You sin because you're a sinner. And it goes on to talk about how sin makes us sinners and brings death, but you can end up being in Christ, in the Lord, if you receive Him as Savior. It's a great gospel tract. Where are the dead? It's a bright red face on it. It's very eye-catching. Please, let me send you that sample packet be ready when my announcer gives our contact information, or just go to our website, which is BibleTractsInc.org. BibleTractsInc.org. All right, Book of Ruth, chapter 1. I'm going to start at verse 3 and then read to verse 5, then jump to the very last verse of the book. Chapter 1, verse 3, "And Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left and her two sons. And they took wives of the women of Moab. The name of the one wife was Orpah, and the name of the other, Ruth. And they dwelt there about 10 years. And Mahlon and Chilion, those are the sons' names, they died also, both of them. And the woman, Naomi, was left of her two sons and her husband. She's a widow, and she has no sons." Go to the very last verse of the book. It says this, "And Obed begat Jesse, and Jesse begat David." Now come back to chapter 1 with me in your Bible. Ruth is a book that opens with death and ends with David. That's King David, of course. Now, something unique is going to transpire here. And what transpires in Ruth and the way that it happens is really quite the story. It's a story not only worth knowing about in our heads, but it's a story worth learning from. It's a story of ruin and ruggedness, intrigue, romance, and God's blessing. It's a great story. I always outline any book that I teach through, and so let me give you my big outline for the Book of Ruth. Book of Ruth has 4 chapters, and it's focused on 2 women, Ruth, of course, and then her mother-in-law, Naomi. Each chapter includes the word woman in it, so here, jot them down. Here are my titles. Chapter 1, Damaged Woman. Damaged Woman. Chapter 2, Decided Woman. The word decided. Decided woman. Chapter 3, deliberate woman. Deliberate woman. Chapter 4, distinguished woman. The book of Ruth happens during the era of the time of the book of Judges. Chapter 1, verse 1 tells us that much. Most historians who hold that the Bible is the inspired word of God lean toward the idea that this story happened in the years when Gideon was the judge, but again, that's only an educated guess. Most likely, the judge named Samuel was the man, the human penman, that wrote down the book of Ruth as we have it here. The story was assuredly written down during the time that Ruth lived and so on for future generations, but when David, her relative, became king, everybody would want to know, where did David and his family come from? And since the Google search engine hadn't been around yet, folk had to learn the old-fashioned way. They had to go and read books. It appears Samuel penned this book and brought it up to date, ending with the adding of David's lineage there in the last chapter. Now, friend, no matter who was the penman, this book of Ruth has always been recognized as being inspired of God, belonging in our Bible. If you pick up any good commentary on the Book of Ruth, more than likely, they're going to tell you that there are 3 key ideas you got to see in the Book of Ruth. And I think they're absolutely right. Let me give you those 3 big ideas, the 3 big lessons. Lesson number 1, idea number 1 is this. Ruth has a moral value for us. The Book of Ruth has a moral value for us. The moral value is this. Even in the worst of times, no matter how polluted with sin a society may get, faithfulness to God and purity before God and others is a possible thing. Now, that truth encourages me to be faithful, but it also pinches me when I think of times when I haven't been so faithful. I have no excuse. Ruth, Naomi, they were women of faith in perilous times. Boaz, a man of faith in perilous times. That's lesson number 1. Lesson number 2 is this. The Book of Ruth has a doctrinal value for us. You see, this book is a tremendous picture of the idea of redemption. God has promised and God has purposed to provide redemption for his people. And my key thought here behind the word redemption is the idea of freedom. You see, remember Egypt And the Israelites there in Egypt, they were there in bondage, but God redeemed them at that event called the Passover. You see, sin held the Jews there in Egypt. God freed them. But once they got out of Egypt and they began to live under their own precipice there, under their own leading of God, they found that they were still sinners and sin held the Jews away from God. But God's law, the law of Moses, gave a means of freedom or redemption from sin. Some in Israel ended up having to go into servitude to other Jews due to financial loss. And some of the Jews lost their lands due to financial bankruptcy. But God gave them the year of Jubilee to set people and land free. God redeemed them. All of this, of course, leads up to Jesus, who is the ultimate redeemer. But here in Ruth, there's a man. His name is Boaz, and he becomes Ruth's redeemer. He could do the job because he was a kinsman. He belonged to the right family. And then Boaz is a tremendous picture of Jesus. Jesus became one of us to redeem us. He came and took on flesh and dwelt among us, that we through him, through Jesus, can be saved. He took not the form of angels. He became a human being to die and redeem human beings from their sin. Here's the third big idea. The book of Ruth has a faith value for us, a faith value for us even today. Three people in this book act out of their faith in God. Ruth does, of course, her mother-in-law, Naomi, does, and then the man named Boaz. In the time when everyday people were living their everyday lives under their own rules and for their own reasons and for their own life purposes, in that kind of era when everybody did that which was right in their own eyes, God tells us that there were people who were faithful followers of him in the midst of it all. Their faith was in God. Even when all hope seemed to be lost, all they were bankrupt and they were under the stigma of being non-Jews and so on, all this proved to be a great source of blessing from God as they lived out their faith before God and before those around them. Three individuals were blessed, yes, but so were their children after them, their children and their children's children. And so was the entire town blessed in which they lived. The town is Bethlehem. You see, God blesses trust, people that trust him. God blesses those that commit their way into him. God blesses faithfulness to him. The New Testament puts it this way, moreover, brethren, it is required in a steward, or talking about a believer who is living their life and their faith out, is required in a steward that a man, a believer, be found faithful. Dear friend, you know Christ today? Are you and I being faithful? That's the one requirement. If we do that, our blessing will come on not just us, but those that follow us and maybe even the town in which we live. God, help us to learn how to be faithful from the book of Ruth.
Thank you for joining us today for Bible Tract Echoes. If you would like to receive a free sample packet of our tracts, you can contact us by calling 309-828-6888. Our mailing address is Bible Tracts, P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. Again, our phone number is 309-828-6888. And our mailing address is P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. You can also contact us through our website. Our web address is BibleTractsInc.org. Remember, the word tracts is spelled T-R-A-C-T-S. That address is BibleTractsInc.org. May the Lord richly bless you as you serve him.